Why live a normal life when you could be living the abundant life? Welcome to the Abundant Life Program with Ashley and Carlie Terades.
Hello and welcome to Abundant Life. Thanks for joining us today in the lounge. We've got a great program for you today. We're talking about how to attack lack and how to receive God's supernatural provision for your life. You know, we're talking about a number of different things, but today in particular, we're talking about giving and about the power of giving. And the power of giving and receiving, praise God, and how it can change your life. It's changed our life. Amen. And I know a lot of you watching could tell testimonies about how giving has really, you know, God's used giving in your life to give you things, and you've been able to receive from the Lord that way. Amen. So we've looked at previous shows, we looked at God doesn't need your money. We looked at the fact that, you know, God doesn't have needs, God doesn't need your money. We've looked at the fact that, you know what, God is the one who invented giving. God is generous by nature. That's who He is. God is love, God is good, and God is generous. And He doesn't operate outside of love, He doesn't operate outside of His goodness, and He doesn't operate outside of His generosity.
He's the biggest giver.
He's the biggest giver. So if He's asking you to give, it's because He's trying to get more to you, and he's the biggest giver.
Amen.
He really is the biggest giver. In fact, a friend of mine had a church, and one of the people there was a very wealthy man, a very wealthy businessman, and he got offended and left the church. And the pastor was upset, and he said, "My biggest giver's left the church. My biggest giver's left the church." And he was praying, he was going, "God, what am I going to do?" And he felt the Holy Spirit say to him, "The biggest giver's still in your church."
Right.
And he's going, "Well, I get the reports every Sunday, and I don't see it. Who's the biggest giver?" He said, no, the biggest giver's still in your church. And he's going, "I don't see it. The biggest giver's left. He's left the church." And finally, God said, "No, the biggest giver's me. I'm your biggest giver. You know, I'm just using different people to get money to you, but God's the biggest giver."
Amen.
And God's our source, and we need to remember that. God's our source. He's the biggest giver, and He won't be outgiven, praise God. So that's what we're up to. Today we're going to look at what does giving do? So what does, when we give, what does it do? What does it achieve, if you like? Or what's the purpose of giving? What does it do? So the first thing we'll look at is, what does giving do for God? Now, we've already established that giving, we're talking about financial giving here. We could relate this to other areas. You know, you can give your time, you can give of yourselves, you can give of your talents, you can give of your abilities and things like that. But we're talking about how to attack lack in your finances. So we're talking about financial giving here. What does financial giving do for God? We already know God owns the world. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. He owns everything. So God doesn't need our money. But God definitely gets blessed when we give. And that's what I'm going to explain here. So what does giving do for God? The first thing is in Deuteronomy 8:18. This is Deuteronomy 8:18. We've read this verse before, but it's a great verse. It says, "And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you the power to get wealth." See, God has given you the power to get wealth. I love to teach people and show people how to make extra money and how to put their hands to something and how they have the power to get wealth. God has given you a supernatural ability to get wealth, to gain money. That's one of the gifts He's given you. And this is right here in this scripture. He's given you the power to get wealth. He doesn't give you money directly. He gives you the power to get money, wealth.
That's really interesting, I think, because oftentimes, you know, we meet people and we've been there ourselves. Mm-hmm. Well, we just kind of feel like, you know, you look at other people that seem to have it all going together, and they obviously have an abundance for every good work. You can tell that they're on a financial different level. And you can look to people and, you know, it's almost like you start comparing yourselves among yourselves, which the scripture says isn't wise. But that scripture puts everyone on a level playing field.
Right.
Everyone has the ability to gain wealth.
Yeah.
Everybody does. Regardless of what it looks like, regardless if they've been to Harvard Business School or not, everyone has the innate ability given by God to gain wealth.
Yep.
That's powerful.
It's very powerful. And earlier on in this series, we talked about how, you know, there's different things that we can do to appropriate that ability to get wealth, to actually receive God's supernatural provision through the works of our hands. And there's different things we can do. And we're talking about diligence and about the spirit of excellence and things like that. So it's not automatic. Everyone's got the same opportunity, but not everyone gets the same results because not everyone does the same things to appropriate those results.
But if everyone did do those things, then
The results are guaranteed.
Right.
The Word of God does exactly what it says on the tin.
Yeah.
If you follow the Word of God, and you just as it tells you to, and you believe it, and you do these things, it will do, the results are guaranteed.
Right.
I've read the back of the book, we win.
Amen.
It's like, the results are guaranteed, but it's up to us whether we want to receive those results or not. And a lot of the time, people will see someone prosperous or you know, in a place of prosperity, and they might think, well, how did they just got lucky or whatever? No, they, you know, 9 times out of 10, they did the Word of God, even if they're not believers. They did the principles of the Word of God. And then if they've prospered God's way, then they've definitely done the word of God. It's definitely been God that's given them that prosperity. And it's amazing how that works out. But yeah, the results are, and it doesn't matter. I've got friends, in fact, I've got a friend who was illiterate. He was illiterate, working in a slaughterhouse. Couldn't read or write. I mean, as rough as you can get. I mean, it's like drugs, drink, I mean, all sorts of different things he was involved with in a slaughterhouse. Like I said,
couldn't even read
or write. I mean, this is the type of guy you wouldn't want to meet down a dark alley. I mean, this is like, he was the real deal. Got born again, started to believe the word of God, started to put these things into practice, taught himself how to read or write. I was just with him last weekend.
Yeah.
And now he is a very wealthy real estate owner. He owns a bunch of houses in his area.
Yep.
And more than that, he's actually able to help other people own their own houses.
Yep.
And he's been able to get families on their feet. He runs a network of churches. It just shows you the prosperity of the Lord will work if you put it to work.
Amen.
It's amazing. If you put these promises to work, and, you know, at Terry Does Ministry, this is what our passion is. It's empowering believers in the promises of God. And these promises, you know what, they're always yes and amen to anyone. Doesn't matter where you're from, what your education is, what family you're from, what country you're from. These will work. These promises will work if you work them and if you believe them.
God doesn't show any partiality.
Amen.
He's not up in heaven deciding who's going to prosper and who's going to get well and who's going to be sick and who's going to get poor. Right? I mean, he's given us the word of God. He's given us abundance. He's given us health and wholeness on the inside of us. These are all parts of the atonement that Jesus paid for us. And they're open to everybody. There is no partiality with God, but it's whoever will put faith and belief in the word of God and put faith in that provision that he's already given us.
Amen.
Everybody can access it. So I just feel like somebody's watching that has excluded themselves from the word of God. That's almost said, you know, that's fine for them, but it's not going to work for me. Yeah, it'll work for you. You know, no one's above the word of God, Amen. Right? The word of God will work for you.
Amen. And you know what, if you're there at home and you're watching, you're thinking, it won't work for me, I don't believe it, I'm this, that, or the other, then you're going to get what you're believing for. It's not going to work for you. But if you choose to change that opinion of yourself and start believing the word of God, it will work for you. Like
Amen.
Carly said, whatever circumstance you're from, I could tell you story after story, friends in third world countries that it's worked for. I've seen friends that have been imprisoned, you know, incarcerated, it's worked for them. I've seen people that are illiterate and it's worked for them. These promises, this word of God will work for you if you work it. Praise God. So God, like you said, God's no, he's not partial to people. He's only partial to faith.
He didn't play favorites.
Doesn't play favorites. So what he does, he's
I'm his favorite.
We're all his favorites, is it? Everyone's his favorite. So what does it do for God? It establishes, it helps establish his covenant. I didn't even finish the verse. See that? I got halfway
Sorry,
through
got
the
so
verse.
Sorry, I got so excited.
And we got sidetracked. I didn't even finish the verse. Deuteronomy 8:18. Hopefully you found it by now. I'm halfway through that verse. You will remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers this day. So why does he give us the power to get wealth? So he can establish his covenant. So when we get wealth, when we get money and we give, it helps God establish his covenant. It helps God show his love to the world. It helps God show the world how much he loves them and show the world that he wants relationship with them. And that's what it does. It costs money to build churches, to send missionaries around the world, to put TV programs on, to market the gospel. It costs money to do those things. And when we do those things, put that money into the gospel, I'm telling you, it's helping God establish his covenant and showing the world how much he loves them.
Amen.
The second thing I've got here is it blesses God. This is 2 Corinthians 9:7. It says, God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. It blesses God when we give to him, when we give back to him and say thank you to him. A friend of mine put it this way. He said, you know, he's feeding his little toddler. Thank God we haven't got toddlers anymore. Our kids are all teenagers. But he was TV.
It's a messy age.
He was, what do you call it? Weaning the toddler. I remember that. And food goes everywhere.
Yeah.
But he'd made this food for his toddler and he was weaning it for him. And the toddler was grabbing the spoon and learning how to feed himself. And he was really enjoying it. It was really good food. And then the toddler went, like this to his dad, like, you take some, I want you to take some. And he was really, and the dad was like, oh, it's so sweet. So he took some and he didn't really need it or want it. But just the fact that the toddler was giving back to him really blessed him. So it blesses God when we give back to him. It's a sign that we love him. It's a sign that we're thanking him, that it's all his anyway, that we're thanking him. And in fact, it's a sign of worship. You know, a lot of the times in the Bible, there's times it said they worship. The wise men, when they came to Jesus, it said they worshiped Jesus and they gave him gifts. Mm-hmm. Mary worshiped Jesus, gave him a gift. There's a lot of times when giving gifts was part of worship. So it's thanking God, it blesses God. Another great verse here is Psalms 35:27. Psalms 35:27 says, let the Lord be magnified who takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. Let the Lord be magnified who takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. So God gets magnified. He gets glorified. He gets pleasure when we prosper, praise God, his way. The third thing I got here that we're talking about, what does giving do for God? The third thing I got here is it gives God permission to bless us. He said to me, Ashley, you're saying you've got to give God permission? Well, yeah, God's given us free will. God's given every man free will. And you know what? God wants every man to be, every person to be born again, to come into a relationship with him. He wants everyone to be healed. He wants everyone to be prosperous because that's what he's paid for. That's his promises he's given to us. But not everyone is because it's their choice. It's your choice whether you got born again or not. It's your choice whether you trusted on Jesus or not. So because it's your choice, God's given you free will and therefore you have the choice. So when you give, you're giving God permission into your finances. And a lot of the time people withhold and they basically look after their finances themselves and say, I've got it myself. I don't need your help, God. And what they're saying is they're not letting God intervene in their finances. And maybe it's about fear, maybe it's about whatever it is, they're not letting God into their finances. And God can't have access into something we don't give him permission to access.
That's true.
So that's the third reason. And the fourth reason I've got is it allows God to give us seed. So when we give, it allows God to give us seeds. This is 2 Corinthians 9 and 10. 2 Corinthians chapters 8 and chapters 9, two of the greatest chapters on finances in the Bible you'll find, talking all about money and stewardship and offerings. So this is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10. It says, now may he who supplies, talking about God, may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food, supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. So God supplies seed to sowers. So when we sow, God is able to give us seed. Now, it'd be nice if God gave seed to those who thought about sowing or gave seed to those who were going to sow one day. But no, it says he gives seed to sowers. It's as we sow, the seed we sow increases. Mm. So, it's the seed we sow that increases. He doesn't give seed to consumers. He gives seeds to sowers.
Right.
Now, there's a few things in this. One thing is I like how it says here. It says he gives seed to sowers and bread for food. So God not only gives us seed to sow, but he also gives us bread to eat. He provides for our needs and he gives us seed to sow. And what happens is sometimes as born again believers, we often get the seed and end up eating our seed, which is okay. I mean, you get these health food things now where they're all seeds and all that, right? It's not great.
It's at the bottom of the bird cage.
It's bottom of the bird cage stuff. I know some of them are like, they get the bottom of the bird cage, put it in a bar
put
and sell it
for
like $3 and call it an energy bar, call it a health bar. But some of those
bird seed bar.
Some, I ate one the other day and it broke my teeth. So I was like, this is maybe healthy. But we're not meant to eat seed, okay? The seed is meant to be sown. And likewise, we're not meant to sow our bread. So there's two things here we can get out of whack if we're not careful. We can end up sowing our bread. And I've seen people do this. I've seen people take everything they've got and give it away. Now, if God's directly telling you to do that, then go for it. Because you know what? When God tells you to do something, obey God and leave all the consequences to him. If he's telling you to do that, then he's got a good reason for you to do that. Maybe it's because your heart is with your finances rather than with God. You know, Matthew 6:24 talks about you can only have one master. You're either going to be loyal to one and hate the other, or hate one and love the other. And that's talking about, he said, you cannot serve God and money. That's Matthew 6:24. So maybe God's trying to win your heart back. And that's you know, you need to give everything to prove that, like he did with the rich young ruler. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's the case. But most of the time, the typical situation is God will not ask you to give everything. He'll give you some of your money for bread to eat, to look after your household and to supply your needs, and then seed to sow. And if we eat our seed and sow our bread, that can get us in trouble and that can end up short-circuiting the system. That's why it is, in a way, possible to outgive God. Now, in the last lesson, I said it's impossible to outgive God. God is the biggest giver. You can't outgive God. Well, you can type of outgive God if you give everything he gives you away and you give your bread away, then he's not going to be able to supply your needs because he gives you bread to supply your needs. Then you give it away, then your needs aren't being supplied. So I guess technically you're not outgiving God, but what you're doing is you're short-circuiting the system and God's giving you bread to eat and you're sowing it. And if you sow your bread, it's going to rot. It's not going to work. And if you eat your seed, you're going to be hungry.
Right.
So we need to understand what's bread and what's seed. And this could be another whole series, but just in a nutshell, some of the things you need to ask yourself, are you sowing, are you giving and not taking care of your family? That would be sowing your bread. So I see people, and I've made this mistake sometimes, where I've ended up sowing and giving to other people and other ministries, and then my own family has had to sacrifice, my own family has had to do without. that's normally not godly. That's normally a case of you sowing your bread. So really, you should be giving, you should be looking after your family before you're giving offerings. Now, we're going to look at different types of giving and the priorities on giving. Some giving is a priority ahead of other things. But most of the time, if you're giving extra or giving offerings and you're not looking after your family, you're sowing your bread, because God gives us bread to eat. And I've dealt with a lot of people that have, you know, their families are suffering. I mean, one person, him and his kids, two kids were living in their minivan. Full-time, living in their minivan, been doing it for weeks because he'd just been giving all his money away. And I said, brother, you need to take some of that money and use it as bread and support your family.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a sidetrack. This is why I think Paul talks about, you know, if you're not looking after your own household, you're worse than an infidel. You're worse than an unbeliever. And people say, you know, how can you be worse than an unbeliever? Well, I think an unbeliever, if they've got children, they haven't got a God to just, you know, trust in. They're going to say, well, God's just going to provide for my needs. And sometimes, as born-again believers, as people that believe in the promises of God, we can get lazy and think, well, I'll just give all my money away, and then God's going to have to provide for my needs.
We abdicate our responsibilities.
Yeah, we do. We abdicate our responsibilities to God, and we just say, God, you've got to provide my needs. When really, the way God provides our needs is through our own hands most of the time. It's through what we do is how God supplies our needs. And when we do that, it can actually be a sign, really, it's pride or laziness, or a bit of both, and we just give everything away and say, God's going to have to look after me now. And that's almost blackmailing God. And the point is, worse than an unbeliever, they haven't got a God to do that with.
Right.
So it doesn't matter who they are, you know, unless they've got a mental illness or an addiction, if they can be the heathen of the heathens, atheists of the atheists, don't believe in God at all. If they've got a baby, they're going to provide for that baby. They're going to go and do something to get money to feed that hungry mouth. Mm-hmm. Whereas some Christians are so out of balance, they're like, well, God's going to provide for me, and their kids end up going hungry. So anyway, God gives bread to eat. So make sure that you're using the bread God's given you to provide for your own needs and for your family, and then make sure you're sowing the seed that he gives you. He gives you seed to sow, and that will increase so you can be an even greater giver.
Amen.
Amen? And God gives the best bread. So God can look after your needs better than you can look after your needs. In fact, most of the time in our life, our experience has been God's got given us better things than we would have got ourselves. Time and time again, right? Amen. When it comes to cars, houses, things like that, we do it our way. We end up with substandard. We do it God's way. He gives us better things without any sorrow, without any pain or toil involved. He just gives us even better things. So he can look after his kids better than you can look after you. So basically, make sure that you're sowing your seed and eating your bread. So that's what giving does to God. It establishes his covenant. It helps him establish his covenant. It blesses him. It brings him pleasure. It magnifies him. And it allows him to give us seed. And it gives him permission to increase us. The next thing I want to look at today is what does giving do for us? So giving has various effects. It has effects on God, but giving has effects on us. So when we give financially, what does it do for us? How does giving affect us? This is 1 Timothy 6:10, one of the most misquoted verses in the Bible. Maybe you've heard it this way, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, right? Or money is the root of all kinds of evil is how it's misquoted.
Yeah.
So people with money, it's just evil. It's the root of all kinds of evil. But really here, for the love of money, it's a love of money that is the root of all kinds of evil. In fact, in the Amplified, in the King James, this is the New King James I'm reading, but in the Amplified and the King James, it says, for the love of money is the root of all evil.
Wow.
It says the root of all evil comes from the love of money.
That's a huge statement.
It's a huge statement. I'm going to explain some of that in a minute. But for the love of money is the root of all evil, which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Wow, isn't that? That's a big deal. I mean, we're talking about people that have strayed from the faith, pierced themselves through with many sorrows because they have a love of money. And let me state this as well. You can have a love of money with no money, or you can have a love of money with a bunch of money. I know people with a bunch of money and have no love of money. You know, you can have money as long as money doesn't have you. And it doesn't really matter at this stage what we're talking about, how much money you have or haven't got. This is your attitude towards money.
And you can see that because if you read on down in that same chapter, Timothy gives some instructions to the rich. So God is not saying that money is evil and no one should be rich. Actually, there's instructions here for the rich. Mm-hmm. It says in verse 17, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good that they be rich in good works, ready to give willingly. willing to share, storing up for themselves in a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. So in other words, it's not wrong. Money is not evil.
Right.
But it's where is our attention? Where is our passion? And here, you know, it's specifically talking to the rich, not condemning them for being rich, but basically saying, don't put wealth and earthly riches above our relationship with the Lord.
Amen.
That's the pitfall of being having an abundance in material possessions. If we're not careful, we can start to idolize those, and it can be a distraction from our relationship with the Lord.
And people can do it without things. In fact, a lot of the time, people without money can have a greater love for money.
You can still idolize money
without having had it. Because they see people with it, and that's where covetousness comes from. And they want that stuff, and they think that stuff will bring them happiness.
Mm-hmm.
So now I agree with you totally. It's we have to be very careful of the love of money and wanting money. And you know, I talked about Matthew 6:24, but Matthew 6:24, Jesus says, you know what, you cannot serve two masters. And you know, he wasn't talking about anything, the devil and God or different things. He was talking about money and God. He was talking about you cannot serve mammon, and that's the old English word for money. You cannot serve money and God. You can't have two masters. You've got to serve one or the other. And it's like money is vying for our attention. Money is the thing that can lead us away from God and actually vie for our attention. And people don't realize sometimes when you let the love of money inside you, when you start getting covetous, and jealous, and there's a difference. You know, jealousy is wanting what other people have. Someone has something, you haven't got it, and you want it, and you think, I'd love to have that. Covetousness or enviousness is even worse. That's saying, I want what you have because I haven't got it, and worse than that, I don't want you to have it either. You shouldn't have it because I can't have it.
It's a complete self-centeredness.
It's very self-centered, and it's very a strong emotion, very strong pull, and it actually leads people to do things they would regret. Mm-hmm. I mean, the story in Acts of Ananias and Sapphira. You know, they lied. They came to the Apostle Peter and lied, sold a piece of land and lied about the amount, and ended up dying right then and there. You know, and I don't know all the ins and outs of that story in terms of how that fits in with grace or anything else, but let me tell you this. That was the love of money that caused them to do that. They had a love of money. They didn't even have to do, they could have kept some of that money and been honest and it would have been okay, but because they had a love of money, they lied about it and grieved the Holy Spirit. So I'll tell you, the love of money is a very serious situation. There's a number of times here in the Bible we can read about how the love of money really led people to all sorts of different situations, into places they didn't want to go. We're going to look at Judas in a minute. Judas had a love of money, and that's what ultimately led him to sell Jesus and to pierce himself through with many sorrows. So 1 Timothy 6:9, the verse before that, so we just read 1 Timothy 6:10, verse 6:9, if you back up one verse, says, but those who desire to be rich, okay, in the Amplified it says, those who crave to be rich. So this is something, you crave to be rich, you desire to be rich. This is a dangerous place to be. They fall into temptation and a snare. So those who desire to be rich and have a craving to be rich, it says they fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. It's in the Amplified. So it can bring them into harmful and foolish lusts. You know, crave to be rich. This suggests that they're not actually rich people, by the way, because they're craving to be rich.
Uh-huh.
So this doesn't mean they are rich. They're craving to be rich, and they could fall into harmful lusts. So it's not just the rich people who have love of money. I have to watch this. I have to guard against covetousness. It could be anyone. We all have to watch. But we need money in this world to be able to function. But if we start to have a craving for money, and that can come in a number of ways, discontentment. You can start to get the jealousy. You can start to listen to the enemy when he says, you really need this stuff to be happy, to be content.
It's a lie.
It's the original lie. You know, you need something more than God. You know, he said to Adam and Eve, you need more than God to be happy. You need something more than God and things like that. So we have to really guard against this. And giving is one of the most powerful things we can do to crush covetousness and crush the love of money in our lives. When you give, you're saying you're in control of money. Money is not in control of you. When you give, you're saying, money, you're not my master. I'm telling you what to do rather than you telling me what to do. When money's your master, in Matthew 6:24, when money becomes your master, money will tell you what to do. Money will say, don't give in that offering. Money will tell you, don't do this, don't do that, don't spend this money on this, you can't afford it, you haven't got the money to do that. Money will start telling you where to spend most of your time in the job. You'll take a bigger job with more stress and more pressures just for the money. Money will tell you to move. Money will tell you to spend time away from your kids. Money will tell you to all these things. Money will start telling you what to do, and money will become your master if you're not careful. But when you give, you're showing money, no, I'm in control of you and I'm telling you what to do, and it can really help with the love of money. It can really help that situation of money not being your master and obeying God instead.
I think giving is like the fasting in your finances.
That's good.
You know, when we're trying to overcome unbelief, you know, fasting is a really powerful tool to overcome unbelief, because it says to the flesh, listen, flesh, you might scream at me because you're hungry, but I'm just going to starve you out, because I'm going to live according to what's in my spirit, and I'm going to bring my flesh under control. And so you're fasting your natural flesh to get it under control and rid of unbelief, right? But when we give, it's like the fasting in our finances. It's the fasting, it's the antidote to covetousness.
Yep.
As our flesh is natural, MO, if you like, is to hold, is to keep it all in, is to keep it all for myself because I'm afraid of having lack, whether that's real or just perceived. You know, and when we give, it's like the antidote to that temptation to hold. You want to hold flesh? You want to hold finances? Let me show you. I'm going to give it away.
Yep.
When you do that,
it's showing that you're putting God first. Mm-hmm. It's showing that you're trusting God. It's the action to your faith. You know, James talks about faith without corresponding actions. He uses the word works. Faith without works is dead. Well, faith without corresponding actions isn't really faith. If you have faith, you're going to act. There's going to be some sort of action. If you really believe something, you're going to act. If you really believe in what we're teaching today, you're going to act and you're going to want to give. You're going to want to give and actually show, you know, money that you're putting God first.
Right.
And you're showing me, you know what, you know, Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You're going to be doing that. That's the action to your faith, if you like, when you give. So giving's really going to help you with that. So giving blesses God, and giving blesses you as well. It's a win-win situation. We're nearly out of time, so we're going to come back next time and carry on some of this, the power of giving and how giving can change your life and set you free, praise God. We're going to show you the types of giving, and we're going to show you when to give, when not to give, and things like that. But for now, we want to pray for you.
People.
Yeah, Father God, I thank you for everyone watching and listening to this show. I thank you, Lord, that you are showing them where to give. You're showing them what's their seed and what's their bread. And Lord, I thank you, you're providing for us. You're giving us seed to sow and you're giving us bread to eat. And I thank you, Lord, you're a good father. You're a loving father. You provide for your own household, Lord. You provide for us. And I thank you for that, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that giving is so powerful and you've set it up this way, that we can have victory over our finances, that we can have victory over any type of covetousness or love of money. And I thank you, Lord, that everyone listening today, everyone watching today, Lord, they're going to be set free in this area, and they're not going to have any issue with covetousness or love of money. They're going to trust you and be set free so they can prosper like never before in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Well, thanks for being with us. Until next time, remember, don't just live a normal life. Go out and live the abundant life. We'll see you soon.
To order your copy of the book featured in our program, visit our website, TerraDesMinistries.com. Download your free copy of Ashley and Carly's teaching notes at our website, TerraDesMinistries.com.
Hey, I want to tell you about Carly's confession card she wrote. It's a little card, it's prescription size, and you know, it has verses about who you are in Christ. This is powerful. I use this regularly. You put your name at the top and then you read it to yourself. It says here, I'm a party waiting to happen, 1 Peter 1:8. It says, I've been sanctified, 1 Corinthians 6:11. I'm a child of the King, adopted into his family. It goes on and on. And I'm telling you, if you haven't got one of these yet, go to our website, TerraDesMinistries.com. We'd love to give one of these to you as our gift, completely free. So go to our website, TerraDesMinistries.com, and get your confession card today.